Thank you in advance for watching the short presentation on vestibular ocular motor screening in sports-related concussion. So why should we screen the vestibular ocular motor system? There's ample evidence that suggests that a significant number of athletes with sport-related concussion will experience impairments and symptoms coming from the vestibular ocular motor system. Lau et al. Reported that dizziness at the time of injury in more than 100 high school football players was associated with a 6-fold increase in a protracted recovery from concussion, which he defined as greater than 21 days. Dizziness, which may represent an underlying impairment of the vestibular and/or ocular motor systems, is reported by 50% of concussed athletes, and dizziness more effectively predicted a protracted recovery time relative to any other on-field symptom. Corwin et al. Observed that patients with vestibular insufficiency at their first clinical visit were more likely to exhibit a protracted recovery, specifically abnormalities on vestibular ocular reflex testing or tandem gait performance resulted in an average recovery time of 59 days versus just 6 days for those without vestibular abnormalities. In the study, those who experienced vestibular difficulty scored significantly lower on verbal memory, processing speed, and reaction time compared with those who exhibited no vestibular impairments. And in the study, 81% of pediatric patients evaluated for the study had vestibular impairment. In addition, the vestibular system is organized into two distinct functional units: the vestibular ocular system, whose purpose is to maintain visual stability during head movements, and deficits in this particular system would manifest as symptoms of dizziness and visual instability. The vestibular spinal system is responsible for postural control, and deficits manifest in this system as difficulty with balance. Because these two functional units of the vestibular system are not identical, it is possible to have impairments in the vestibular ocular system without impairments of the vestibular spinal system or balance. So the utility of using a balance assessment alone as a measure of the vestibular system may be limited. What is the significance of having these vestibular and ocular motor impairments? First, ocular motor symptoms, which are present in about 30% of concussed athletes, include blurred vision, convergence insufficiency, diplopia, headaches, and difficulty scanning for visual information. Functionally, these impairments would result in difficulty reading, impaired academic performance, and related cognitive impairments. These functional impairments may be misattributed to a cognitive deficit after concussion instead of an ocular motor problem if not screened or tested for. Vestibular symptoms can be exacerbated by busy environments such as crowded school hallways, quick head movements such as those involved in dynamic sports, as well as balance deficits. So early detection of impairments in the vestibular and ocular motor system is key to help athletes recover quickly and fully from a sports-related concussion. Given the high prevalence of vestibular symptoms and the relationship between these symptoms and a protracted recovery, the vestibular and ocular motor systems should be screened after sports-related concussion and then continually monitored during recovery with referral for targeted treatment, and in this case would be vestibular rehabilitation where indicated. So the vestibular ocular motor screen, or also known as the VOMS, was developed in 2014 at the University of Pittsburgh. The VOMS was designed to be a brief clinical screening tool that was used in conjunction with the other assessments that are typically performed following concussion, such as a neurocognitive assessment, symptom inventory, a balance assessment, as well as the comprehensive clinical examination, interview, and medical history. The current findings from that original study suggest, through the VOMS, that patients with impairments and symptoms in vestibular and ocular motor function after sport-related concussion can be identified. Information from the VOMS may assist in prompting referrals for more targeted vestibular and vision assessments and rehabilitation when any item on the screen is positive, and this information may also assist us in identifying early those who are at risk for a protracted recovery and then making appropriate referrals for intervention The vestibular ocular motor screen, or the VOMS, in addition, is a tool that measures symptom provocation after each assessment of five clinical domains. These include smooth pursuit, horizontal and vertical saccades, convergence, horizontal and vertical VOR, and visual motion sensitivity. We're going to go through these in detail with a short video to show how to perform these as we go through the screening. The VOMS tool has demonstrated strong internal consistency and significant correlation with the post-concussion symptom scale, as well as the ability to potentially differentiate concussed participants from healthy controls. Equipment needed to perform the VOMS is a metronome, a tape measure, a visual target, which with a 14-point font, and the VOMS score sheet. And it takes about 10 minutes to complete the VOMS screening. So first of all, the baseline reporting. Before the test is started, the athlete describes the severity of their symptoms on a scale of 0 to 10 to include headache, dizziness, nausea, and fogginess.
To begin the VOMS screening, we start with getting the athlete to tell us what their baseline symptoms on a scale of 0 to 10. And I'm going to ask Cheyenne what her symptoms are before we start the test, so their baseline. So in terms of headache, on a scale of 0 to 10,
2.
Okay. Dizziness,
0.
Nausea,
0.
Fogginess,
3.
Okay, and then I can put any comments out there if the athlete had any other comments to make in their symptoms.
The first task in the VOMS is to look at smooth pursuit. And smooth pursuit tests the ability to follow a slowly moving target. So to complete this test, the examiner holds their fingertip as the target at a distance 3 feet from the athlete. They're instructed to maintain focus on the target as you move your finger smoothly in a horizontal direction, 1.5 feet to the right, 1.5 feet to the left. One repetition is complete when the target moves back and forth to the starting position, and 2 repetitions are performed. The target should be moved at a rate requiring 2 seconds to go from left to right and 2 seconds to go back from right to left, which on a metronome equates to 30 beats per minute. We repeat the same test, moving in a vertical direction at the same speed, and then record headache, dizziness, nausea, and fogginess after the test.
First thing we're going to set is smooth pursuit, and when I do that, I'm going to hold my target, which is going to be my finger, about 3 feet away from her face. Okay, I'm going to move the target about 1.5 feet to each side, right to left, and one repetition is when I go completely from the right to the left, back to the right, and I should be moving at about 1 repetition, it takes me 2 seconds to go from right to left. So my metronome is set at 30 beats per minute. I'm going to do 2 right to left and 2 up and down. So Cheyenne, I'm going to have you follow my finger from here. Here we go. Keep your head still, twist your eyes. And then I would ask her to reassess her symptoms. So after that test, in terms of headache, on a scale of 0 to 10?
2.
Dizziness?
0.
Nausea?
0.
Fogginess?
3.
Okay. And I could also write any comments. If I notice any difficulty with achieving nice, smooth, coordinated movements of the eyes or corrective saccades where she loses the target and has to jump to it, I would certainly put that in the comments after that test.
Next is horizontal saccades. The saccade system tests the ability to move quickly between 2 targets. So for this test, we use 2 targets or 2 points, which are the fingertips, horizontally at a distance of 3 feet from the patient, 1.5 feet to the right and left. So the patient has to move their gaze 30 degrees to the left and 30 degrees to the right. We would instruct them to move their eyes as quickly as possible from point to point. 1 repetition is complete when the eyes move back and forth to the starting position, and 10 repetitions were performed, and again, we would record their symptoms at the completion of the test on a scale of 0 to 10.
The test we look at is the saccadic movement. We're going to do it horizontal as well as vertical. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my fingers as targets. I'm going to be 3 feet away from Cheyenne. I'm going to have them about a foot and a half on either side. I'm going to ask her to move her eyes as quickly as she can from the right to the left, back to the right. I'm going to count one complete motion from right to left, back to right is one, and I'm going to have her do it 10 times. So I want you to move your eyes looking in between the two fingers as fast as you can for 10 times. Ready? You can begin.
The next test is vertical saccade. So we would perform the exact same sequence. The only difference is the two targets would be placed in a vertical orientation, and she would move her eyes up and down for the same 10 repetitions.
We'll do the same thing. I'm going to hold one target about a foot and a half above, a foot and a half below. I'm going to have you do the same thing, 10 repetitions, and looking with one finger and then the other. Go ahead. Four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Good. And what I would be looking for is to see if she has nice, quick, coordinated movements. She was able to maintain on the target, not lose the target, and I would go ahead and ask her to rate her symptoms for those, for headache, dizziness, nausea, fogging, and just...
The next item we look at is convergence, or the ability to view a near target without double vision. If the athlete wears glasses or contacts, then of course they would wear these during this test. What we have the athlete do is look at a target. It's approximately a 14-point font size, beginning at arm's length, and slowly bring it toward the tip of their nose. They're instructed to ignore blurring of the image, but to tell us by stopping the target when they see two distinct images or when the image doubles. Okay. We're also observing for any outward deviation of the eye so that the eyes don't converge together and team together as the target comes closer. The distance in centimeters between the target and the tip of the nose is measured and recorded, and we repeat this 3 times. We would also record any change in symptoms of their headache, dizziness, nausea, and fogginess after the test. And near point convergence, anything 6 centimeters or greater from the tip of the nose is considered to be abnormal. Oops, let me back up here and catch that video. Here we go.
What I'm going to have Cheyenne do is start, she's going to use a target with a font with 14 point. I've just got an X on a pencil that she can hold. She's going to start with the target out in front of her, and I'm going to ask her to move it. Grab my tape measure. I'm going to ask her to move the target toward her slowly, and when she sees two or the target doubles, I'm going to measure the distance from the tip of her nose to the target in centimeters. Okay. So that's 4 centimeters, and anything 5 centimeters or less is considered normal. I would have her do that 2 more times, so I do it 3 times. I would document that, so let's just do it 1 more time, just for the sake of demonstration. Okay, good. And that was about 5, okay? I would measure that, like I said, 3 consecutive times, and then I would again ask her to rate her symptoms, her dizziness, nausea, headache, or fogginess following that test.
Moving on, the next test is the vestibular ocular reflex, also known as the VOR. This tests the ability to stabilize vision as the head is moving. So we start with the horizontal VOR. The athlete would hold the 14-point font size in front of the patient in midline at a distance of 3 feet. We ask them to rotate their head horizontally while maintaining focus on the target. The head is moved at an amplitude of 20 degrees to each side, and a metronome is used to ensure the speed of rotation is maintained at 180 beats per minute. And they would move their head each direction 1 beat. So 1 repetition is completed when the head moves back and forth to the starting position. 10 repetitions are performed. In this particular test, we still record the headache, dizziness, nausea, and fogginess, but we wait 10 seconds after the test is complete before asking them to rate their symptoms.
Your ocular reflux, and what I'm going to have Cheyenne do is hold the same target, and that's 14 font text. I'm going to ask her to turn her head side to side, about 20 degrees each direction, while she's maintaining focus on the target. I'm going to set my net metronome at 180 beats per minute. And so each time she turns her head right, left, back to right, that's one repetition, and we're going to do that 10 times. And she's going to pace herself using the metronome, and her head moves each beat. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
We complete the same examination, but in a vertical fashion for the vertical VOR.
Thing, and I'm going to have you move your head up and down, okay? About 20 degrees each direction, 10 times at the same pace. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then again, I would ask her to rate her symptoms, the same scale on a scale of 0 to 10, those same symptoms that we've used previously.
And the last test of the VOMS is visual motion sensitivity. This test, the ability to inhibit vestibular-induced eye movements using vision when the head and the body is moving. So in this particular test, the athlete would stand with feet shoulder-width apart, facing generally a busy area of the clinic or the room, so that there's a complicated visual background as the target is moving. And we're looking to see if that particular visual input or that would produce symptoms. They hold their arms outstretched, focus on their thumb. They're going to maintain focus on the thumb as they rotate their body together as a unit at an amplitude of 80 degrees to the right and 80 degrees to the left. We use a metronome again to make sure our speed is consistent at 50 beats per minute. And one repetition is completed when the trunk makes a complete rotation from right to left and back to right. Five repetitions are performed. And as always, we then record their symptoms following the test.
Visual motion sensitivity. What I'm going to try and do is hold her arms outstretched, focusing on her thumbs. I'm going to have her rotate her trunk to the side about 80 degrees, turning the head and the trunk and keeping her eyes focused on her thumbs. Okay. I'm going to set a pace for her with using my metronome at 50 beats per minute, and she's going to do five complete cycles. So here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And the same thing after she completes that, I'll have her rate her symptoms on that scale of 0 to 10 for dizziness, headache, nausea, and fogginess.
So how do we score the VOMS, or what is considered significant? So on any item, a cutoff score of greater than 2 total symptoms after any VOMS item, or a near point conversion score distance of greater than 5, resulted in higher rates of identifying concussions. So what we're saying is we look at each of the symptoms across the column on the VOMS score sheet. If the athlete scores greater than 2 on any of those symptoms, headache, dizziness, nausea, or fogginess, for any item, that's considered an abnormal score and should be looked at with additional evaluation and assessment. The combination of the VOR, the vestibular motor screening, and the near point conversion scores resulted in a positive prediction rate of 0.89 for identifying concussions. So the VOMS appears to assess vestibular and ocular motor symptoms, which are unrelated to current clinical balance measures. Abnormal symptoms and/or provocation of symptoms may indicate dysfunction and should trigger a referral to the appropriate healthcare provider.